Okay, if I could, I'll call our meeting to order. I appreciate everyone being here this evening. First item on our agenda is to establish, call our meeting to order and establish a quorum. We do have a quorum of our board team here, so I appreciate everyone being here. Our second item, we're honored this evening to have Reverend Brenda Warren from First Christian Church, and she's going to lead us in our invocation.
It's an honor to be with you this evening. Please join me in prayer. Our God of past, present, and future, we gather together this evening as the board members of the San Angelo School District. Only mere days before Christmas and only steps away from the threshold of 2019. Oh God, we desire to do good and honorable work, and we seek to represent fairly and well those who have given us this task. May our personal faiths give us clear insight, our deliberations be filled with divine wisdom, our work with clarity and accuracy, and our decisions with impartiality. May we always act in accordance with what is best for San Angelo and our students and our faculty and parents and our fellow citizens. So we ask this in your name. Amen.
Thank you, Reverend Warren. We really appreciate that. Next on our agenda is our pledges. So as I announce these students, they're going to come forward. We have Kaven Gary, Alisa Chapoy, Gino Mendez, Desiree Galvan, and Misael Rodelo. So if y'all will come forward, and while they're coming forward, if everyone would stand, they're going to lead us in our pledges. Okay, and they're going to stay up here if parents would like to take a picture or anything like that. You can come forward a little bit further if you need to. Just get up there and, yeah, we really appreciate it. Thank y'all so very much. We appreciate y'all being here. I'll read our introduction script and before we start our meeting. Good evening and welcome. As the President of the Board of Trustees of the San Angelo Independent School District, I'd like to welcome all of you who are present at tonight's regular board meeting. I also welcome those of you who might be watching the tape of this meeting on our public access channel, Channel 4. We appreciate your interest in our students. All items that will be discussed at our meeting this evening have been posted as required by state law. Also, as you may be aware, our board meets a minimum of 2 times per month, and most, if not all, of our items on our agenda this evening have been previously discussed in an earlier pre-agenda board workshop. As members of the San Angelo Independent School District's Board of Trustees, we're here to set goals, listen to reports from our superintendent, approve budgets, contracts, and personnel appointments, and to make policy for the district. Please keep in mind that our meeting is a meeting of the Board of Trustees held in public and not a meeting of the public. However, with that in mind, we have an item on every one of our meeting agendas that allows anyone present who wishes to speak to our board team the opportunity to do so. I will make certain that we give everyone an opportunity to speak on any item not listed on our agenda. Additionally, prior to taking any votes, I will ask audience members if they would like to make any comments at that time. Anyone wishing to make comments on any agenda item should do their best to limit their comments to 3 to 5 minutes. In compliance with Texas state law, these proceedings are recorded and will become a part of our permanent legal record. In order that our tape might adequately reflect the proceedings, I ask that you please refrain from talking while others might be speaking. And I also ask, as I remind my fellow board team members, to please turn off or silence your cell phones at this particular time. Again, it's my pleasure to welcome everyone to tonight's meeting. We thank you for taking the time to join us. We appreciate your interest in the activities of our students and the business of our district. And certainly one of the things that the board really enjoys doing each year is recognizing our students. So this evening, we're going to do that. So I'm going to ask our Executive Director of Athletics, Brent McCauley, to come forward, and he's going to lead us in that exercise. Thank you for being here.
As always, Dr. Detloff, Mr. Lehman, Board of Trustees, we appreciate the opportunity to be here to spend a little time with our student athletes. We've had a great fall. A lot of great things have gone on both of our campuses. We've had a couple of firsts this fall as well, and I'll let the coach talk about that. But we have a lot of great young athletes, student athletes that do a great job. They represent our schools both home and away, and we are certainly proud of that part of it as well. I want to first thank, and she's not in here, but Julie Quam is out in the hall, ramrodding all this out here, but thank God for Julie, that's for sure. But anyway, we'll begin. We're going to do it by sport this time, and we're going to have the cross-country teams first, and we will have Coach Leeper and the Lakeview cross-country up first. Coach, come on up.
As they line up, I just want to say thank you so much for recognizing us and giving the kids this opportunity to show off to you guys and just for showing us your appreciation. Thank you. This is the Lakeview cross country team, or this is the team who advanced past district. We have one girl up there, Jade Parker, and she advanced as an individual. She placed sixth at district, and she's not even really a cross country runner. She's a hurdler, so she just did her best and was really amazing. So she ended up going to regionals and did really, really well. The boys, the one on the end, he'll wave, Jesus. He advanced as an individual and as part of the team, so the whole team did advance. Before I tell you all their names, I would like to recognize Levi. He'll wave. He played a really, really important role as one of our athletes got hurt and couldn't compete at district. He actually filled in for him and then stepped down to let his teammate run at regionals. And so that's actually, I mean, really amazing. Like, I'm so proud of him and for him stepping down and stepping up when he needed to. Starting on the end closest to me, these are the boys who advanced to regionals. Alexis Ledesma, he's a freshman. John Gloria, a sophomore. Caleb Calcote, a junior. And then Jade Parker, she's a junior. Sergio Mendoza, a senior. Levi Grimes, a senior. Lupe Hasso, a senior. And Jesus Espinoza, a senior. So we'll be losing a lot, but thank you.
Okay, next up, Coach Meek in the Central High School cross country group.
Just to repeat right quick what Coach Leeper said, we really do appreciate all of your support. Thanks for having us. I've been doing this for a long time. This may be the most amount of parents we've seen here too, so thank you all for your support. This is four of the seven boys on the team that advanced to the regional meet. I think the other three were on a long run, and they didn't make it back in time, so that's where they are. I'm going to go ahead and mention everybody's names, but we had a couple of seniors, and these are two that are not here, Caleb Martinez and Antonio Uriegas. They were four-year varsity runners for us, did a great job. We do have two of our juniors, Jaden Fowler and Arat Silva Gonzalez. It's our two juniors who they didn't run as freshmen. We got Arat as a sophomore, and Jaden as a junior, so that's not very common for a kid to decide they're going to run cross country after a couple of years of high school, but they really did help us and made us a lot better. One sophomore, Matt Pertel, and then one of our freshmen is here. We had two, Sebastian Espinoza, And then Stephen Tucker is the other freshman that was not able to be here. But this group did advance to the regional meet. We lost a good group of seniors last year, and we knew it was going to be a tough year. So to advance to the regional meet was a major goal. And these guys worked hard for it. And it came down to the wire. We always talk about the importance of every place counts. Every runner counts. Cross country is scored like golf. So low score wins. Well, it actually came down to a tiebreaker, third place. Cross country is a sport where only the top three advance. So it came down to the tiebreaker. Sebastian happened to be our number six runner. He beat the number six runner from the team that we tied with, and that we were able to advance. And he gets credit for being the tiebreaker, but it really came down to everybody doing their part and making sure to go get one more and don't let anybody catch you. And that's what they did. And we're looking forward to all of these guys that are coming back, and I look forward to hopefully being back again next year to see y'all. So thank you.
Okay, next up will be the tennis teams. We'll begin with Lakeview High School. Coach, come on up.
Good evening, everybody. I'd, of course, like to thank the board for letting us come and introduce my team today. The team right here is a record-shattering Lakeview tennis team. We really got to give it to them, you know. We got a big team here. You know, everybody thinks tennis is an individual sport, but here in the fall, there you go, y'all. Just back it up. All right. Here in the fall, we have team tennis. We get together, and what you do is you play. You as a lineup, you play number one, number two, number three, number four, number five, number six. Okay. And the deal with that is the number one boy is just as important as the number six boy, six girl. Doesn't matter. Okay. A point's a point for that. And as we went through the year, we had some renowned success. We won district for the first time. We won by district. We won area, and we ran into a really tough number five in the state, Vernon High School, and we ended up coming short. But by golly, I'm very proud of these kids, you know, and they deserve every bit of recognition that they can get. So I'll go ahead and start with Francisco Mendoza. He's a senior. He can wave. Here you go. You got Eric Torres. He's a sophomore. You can wave too. Did he? Okay, good. Good, Eric. Thank you. Sebastian Casillas, he's a senior. You got Eric Perez as a junior. Chris Moreno as a sophomore. Jackson Johnson as a senior. Ethan Benavides was an alternate, but he was sure helpful with the cheering. He's also a sophomore. And we have Stetson Cherid right here at the end. He's a sophomore, and he was our manager. Very important to have him around. I know the team, you don't always know what the manager does, but things get done, you never know how, and that's him. So, okay, and on the girls' side, we got Victoria Hernandez, she's a senior. Got Alicia Cappuccina, she's a sophomore. Emily Hahn as a senior. Shay Price as a junior. Crystal Rodriguez as a senior. Haley Torres as a sophomore. Kaylin Hayes as a junior. Veronica Morales as a sophomore. Madison Getz as a sophomore, and then we had Alyssa Lechuga as a sophomore coming in as our girl alternate, also very crucial with the cheering. In our singles lineup, every single kid on the entire lineup got all district, which is amazing. So give them a hand. So clearly very proud of this crew, and the great thing about tennis is we have another season in about a month, so we're going to get right back on the court and hopefully get the same kind of success. So we thank you for having us, and go Chiefs. All right, Stetson. Yeah. Here you go. Let's follow the line.
Thank you.
Okay, the Central High School tennis team, Coach Abelez, come on up, please, sir.
All right. Well, first off, thank you all for having us. Thank you, the administration, everybody, Central High School. We appreciate it. Before we get started, I'd like to say thank the parents. Without them, this wouldn't happen. You know, thank you to the administration for the facilities and the things that you do to help ensure these kids' future and everything that they have on the court, whether the nets, the courts, just everything that comes with it. We couldn't thank you all enough. We appreciate everything you do for our team and our school and the coaches and the kids. So I'm going to go ahead and introduce the 2018-2019 Central High School tennis team. We went 17-6 on the year. We got second place in district in a close match. We lost 8-11 to Abilene High. And we were bi-district champions, beating Fort Worth Paschal 10-4. And then we went on to the next round, and we met up with a very good Tascosa team who we beat earlier in the season in a tournament in Abilene. They just came out on top on that match, close match. I'd say it's because we didn't have our assistant coach, but she had other things that day. But I will say that the Tascosa team we met up with ended up making it to state. So we ended up losing to a state qualifying team in 6A that we had previously beat in the season. So I think that's a great thing for us and these kids, and it's only going to go up from here. But I'm going to go ahead and introduce our seniors first. If you'd step out and just give a little wave. Natalie Pfluger, David Hensley, Brinson Harmon, Bobby Hirschfeld, Rohan Kamalapur, Colby Bixler, and Billy Cuellar. Juniors, Addison Henson, Chandra Ross, Vivian Yale, Cameron Clark, Pablo Munoz, Weston Savarance. Sophomores, Jenna Fuentes, Hallie Jost, Kaori Neal, McKenna Debitch, Kelsey Bishop, Richie Ramos, Michael Martinez, Silvedio Contreras, Cameron Coker, and of course our fishies, Olivia Henderson, Trinity Pfluger, and Sam Kempassi. Hoorah. Real quick, my first year here, so thank you, and it's a privilege, and I hope to be back next year if you want me back. But I will say, many of these kids got all district honors. That I did not have. I was told to keep this short and sweet, so had I known, I would have pulled out all the works and everything that they had accomplished throughout the year. We had MVPs, we had newcomer of the years, we had first team all districts and second team all districts. We pretty much swept the entire categories with everything, and it goes into the hard work and dedication of these kids. And like I said, we couldn't be done without the parents and the administration and the support of our school. So thank you all very much. We appreciate it.
Thank you.
Okay, the next group up is the Central High School volleyball team. Coach Bozarth.
Thanks so much for having us. We always love to have the opportunity to brag on these girls. They sure do a lot of good things in this community and for our school. This group took on the challenge of the new district and all the travel that went with that. They didn't ever look back. They finished the year at 32-8, 11-1, and they were district co-champs. We defeated Weatherford in the final match of the regular season. They were ranked number 10 at that time in the state. They, at one point, later after that, ranked as high as number 6. We came back and beat them, and so that was an awesome, awesome memory that they had. We finished the season ranked number 21 by the Texas Girls Coaches Association. They finished third at the Need of Annoy and Duncanville tournaments, fourth at San Marcos. They helped raise over $12,000 for CH graduate Zach Sutterfield, who was badly injured in a fire last summer. And on top of that, they're just great people. It's a great, great group to go to work every single day. And they got a lot of individual awards, so I'll just try to shoot through those real quick as we introduce them. Number one, Senior DS Clara Knapp. Clara was named Academic All-District and Academic All-State. Number two, Senior Libero Addie Bonaventure. Addie was named Second Team All-District, Academic All-District, Texas Girls Coaches Association Academic All-State, and All-West Texas. She led our team in digs and was voted the Leadership Award by her teammates. Number three, Senior Utility Kaylee Ochenang. Kaylee was one of two players who received our Tough Award this year. Number four, Junior DS Caroline Detloff. Caroline was named Academic All-District and voted by her teammates as our best communicator. That's a good thing. That's a good thing. Number five, sophomore, setter DS hitter, Maya Moore. Maya was named Academic All-District, and she received our most versatile player award. Number six, junior middle right side, Chelsea Weldon. Chelsea was named Academic All-District and honorable mention All-District. Number seven, sophomore outside hitter, Steely Poss. Steely was named Academic All-District and earned honorable mention. Number 10, senior DS Anastasia Candela. Anastasia was named second team All-District. Number 11, senior middle right side, Kirsten Gomez. Kirsten was named second team All-District. Number 12, senior right side, Sierra Bradley. Sierra was named Academic All-District, Academic All-State, and she received our other Tough Award. Number 14, junior setter, Veronica Guerrero. Veronica was named First Team All-District, Academic All-District, All-West Texas, All-Tournament at San Marcos and Duncanville, and she earned our Hustle Award this year. Number 15, senior outside middle right side, Trinity Southall. Trinity was named First Team All-District, Academic All-District, Academic All-State, All-West Texas Outstanding Hitter at the Need of Annoy Memorial, All-Tournament at Duncanville, and she was also our Hollins Award winner. And this season, she finished as Central's all-time kill leader. Through her 4 years on varsity, she accumulated 1,509 kills. So that's pretty awesome. Number 16, junior middle right side, Presley Knowlton. Presley earned Academic All-District and was voted most improved by her teammates. And wearing number 62? Millsap, Coach Millsap, he's my lovely assistant. Couldn't do any of this without him. Thanks again for letting us come here and brag on these girls. And we're certainly proud of them. They're going to do big things once they're finished with Central High School.
Okay, up next is football, and we'll begin with Lakeview High School and Coach Guevara.
Hey, good evening. Thank you for having us here tonight. It's our pleasure being here. First of all, I'd like to thank you guys, the school board, the administration, not just here at admin, but at Lakeview, for all the support they have given us and provided for us, for these young men. As you can see, none of all of our kids showed up today, but some are still working or not here, but of course, obviously not here, but working. It was a trying year. We started off well. We competed well with in our preseason. As you can tell, I'm a little nervous. I didn't expect a mic in front of me today. But now these kids, we're trying to establish a good base for Lakeview and just go up. And we're excited to be a part of the program, making the change, build on what's been there before. But we're, like I said, the kids, they never gave up, and that's the main thing. They continue to pull through, and thick and thin, they kept fighting, never gave up. It was obvious that there's some games that we weren't in, but they continued to come to practice through preseason. District came around, they kept fighting, kept playing. We had a really tough district. They finished strong, beat Big Spring in a big game at home. We traveled to Fort Stockton. Fort Stockton played a very, very good Mountain View team. They showed their character. They were in the ball game. Never lost the lead. They battled through, and in the very end, they just stuck together and they won the bi-district championship. And there you see Julian holding that trophy that we're very proud of. We got the pleasure to face a good Wichita Hershey team, and these kids, they put on a good show. They really fought. They played well. They fought. Just came up short. They had a really good ball club, but we're excited. The direction we're headed, the community support, booster club, we are humbled to be where we're at, and we thank you. And thank everyone that's behind us and supporting our team, our kids. And I'd like to thank our coaching staff, the countless hours they put through throughout the week, early in the morning, late in the evening. These young men, I mean, these young guys are at school at 6, some at 7, but 6 most of the time. But they're there. They're the first ones there at school. And the last ones to leave during football season. And that says a lot about their character. There's a lot of sacrifice involved into what they do, and not just us, but every kid in extracurricular activities. I'm real proud of them. I can't say enough. And thank you for having us here. And they represented our district well in all district nominations. We had some kids nominated. We had kids nominated for academic all-state, academic all-district. So we're excited the direction we're headed. And once again, thank you for having us here. And hopefully next year we're standing here again in front of you, and I will be better prepared and not as nervous. I'll ask for a mic for Christmas so I can practice. But thank you once again. Appreciate it.
Thank you. Yeah, they're going to look at it. It might just be something they trim up. You know, when he'll be back in 4 or 5 weeks, and they have to repair it.
Yeah, go ahead, guys. Okay, the last group here, Central High School football, and Coach Davis.
Y'all can make another line, like in front of that line, if you need to. Yeah. You go ahead and make another line. I want to thank the board for having us tonight. We're very privileged to be here at San Angelo ISD and all the support that we get from our administration and our school board and our high school administration also. It's a great place to coach. It's a great place to go to school. We're very proud to be from San Angelo. And a great group of young men that we have right here. Had some adversity this year, had some injuries, and had some other things that really affected our football team, but we never quit and we never gave up and we found a way, going into district, a different new district, tougher district than what we've been in. These guys just kept fighting. You know, every game we played as hard as we could and got after it. Ended up 7-4, making the playoffs, third place in district. Some people were a little disappointed, but with the things that we went through as a group and as a football team, I'm very proud of this team. I'm very proud of what they overcame, and I'm very proud of their fight. And there were a lot of games that we had to come back and win. Abilene was one that sticks out. We kick a field goal with no time on the clock to win the game, 17-15. Miles Hauser, I think he's at soccer practice today, but is he here? He is here? Where you at, Miles? I didn't see you come in. Raise your hand. All right. Had to talk Miles into playing. And I've kind of told that story before, but glad he did. You know, he really did. It's a lot of pressure to go out and kick a field goal to win a district football game that actually, in the end, gets you in the playoffs. And because if we lose that game, we're not in the playoffs. So big deal for us. And great young man that kind of came through for us this year. We had a bunch of tight games like that. The Richland game was tight. The Bell game was tight. And we persevered in most cases. So very proud of these young men. All the accolades haven't come out yet. But we've got great kids here. We've got some academic all-state kids. We've got some all-district kids. I will say one thing about Malachi Brown. He was the newcomer of the year in our district, and I thought that was very deserved, too. He kind of, got thrown into a deal where he wasn't expecting it to happen, and he stepped up and really played well all year. Very proud of him. Very proud of all these guys, and it's a pleasure to coach them. I want to introduce our coaching staff real quick. Y'all come on in, guys. Y'all get out there. These are our managers right here. These guys do a great job for us, too. Come on in, guys. Mark Chester, Kevin Crane, Regan Krim, Colton Buzzard, B.J. Patello, Larry Holscher, and Marty Hauser. That's Miles' dad that I had to talk him into it, too. So not all of our guys are here. Some of them are coaching. You know, we had some coaching basketball and some coaching soccer, so they're not all here. But this is our 2018 Bobcat football team. Very proud of them. Thank you. Y'all turn this way and make a little line right here.
Thank you.
Okay, if we could keep our administrative team quiet over there, we'd start our meeting. Oh, I'm sorry. So, thank you all for setting that up, and I appreciate all the hard work that all of our coaches and certainly they did. I know of our coaches did a lot to thank our parents, and it doesn't happen without really involved parent and teacher team, and our coaches are doing a great job. So we appreciate everybody being here for that recognition. Our next item on our agenda is I referred to earlier, anyone wishing to make comments to our board team on items not on our agenda, now would be a great time to do so. I see no one wishing to do that, so we'll move forward to the approval of our minutes. Do we have a motion?
Move to approve.
Thank you. We have a motion. Do we have a second?
Second.
We have a motion from Mr. Hernandez and a second from Mr. Dendel to approve the minutes of our November 12th, 2018 finance and pre-agenda board workshop and our November 19, 2008 regular board meeting. Are there any questions or comments concerning our minutes? Any public comment? If not, all in favor, please indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed, indicate by saying no. Our motion passes. Our next item is reports. We have a student enrollment report for the 14th Monday of school, which was actually November 26th, so it's about 3 weeks behind what our current enrollment is, but I think it shows that we're about 60 students down so to last year, but still we appreciate the confidence that parents have in sending their students to SAISD. And the next thing is our second 6 weeks average daily attendance. I think we're up about 0.35% on that. So that's how districts get paid. So it's important that kids go to school. So we're up slightly compared to the same 6 weeks period last year. Item C, we're going to get an update this evening on academic progress. And I believe Dr. Ritter and Cherie Braden are going to help us with that. So Dr. Ritter.
Thank you so much, Dr. Dutloff, Mr. Lehman, members of the board. I'm happy to introduce our elementary curriculum and instruction team, and they're going to come on up here and provide you with some information, a report on academic progress in our elementaries, an update on our district initiatives. I think you'll be excited to see this progress and hear from them about the work that is being done in our elementaries, and we appreciate some of our elementary principals who came up here to support tonight as well. So if you have questions, we're here to answer questions when we're through. So I'm gonna turn it over to Cherie at this time. And so let me introduce, first of all, this is Cherie Braden, our Director of Elementary Curriculum and Instruction. Lorraine Campos here, she is our facilitator, content facilitator for math and science. And Stacey Lamkin is our facilitator, content facilitator for English Language Arts and Social Studies.
So thank you for having us. We are excited to tell you about the work that we've been doing, the curriculum department. We've had Scholastic and Math Solutions come in and provide training for us. And using that training, we're hoping with our principals, instructional coaches, and the leadership at our campuses to build capacity with our leaders so that they're able to influence teaching and learning on the campuses. And we are also training teachers in best practices through those companies. They're helping us with making sure that all teachers are understanding best practices with the hope that they're taking that training back and in implementing in their classrooms. And we are also hoping that the end goal with students is at least 1 year or more's growth in reading and in math. And the best thing is that we're having consistency across the district. So all teachers, all principals, all instructional coaches, everyone is getting the same training. We've brought the training into the campuses, so teachers are actually getting to see the training in their classrooms with their students, and we're seeing a lot of success with that. Also, we have brought in resources that y'all have been so grateful to help us with. And so the resources are aligned across our district. So all campuses have the same instructional resources for the first time ever. So we're real excited to share a little bit about the resources and the trainings that we have been doing in the last 2 years with our curriculum department. And Stacy Lampkin is going to share a little bit about the reading resources.
Okay, one of the things that we have, we purchased, I believe, last year is the Next Step in Guided Reading Assessment Kit. And the kits were given to each elementary. We use them in grades K through 5. They have 4 different parts to them. There's a reading interest survey, a word knowledge inventory, a comprehension assessment, and then the most important piece really is the reading assessment conference. And that reading assessment conference is used with the teachers to really, they assess the students and it provides them with information and tells them where those students are, what they need to hit on in their small group reading instruction. And the NSGRA is given 3 times a year. It's given at the beginning of the year, the middle of the year, and then the end of the year. Another thing that we've been very fortunate to have, this has been a really big hit with our teachers this year, is the leveled book room. And the leveled book room is full of books that are high interest levels. We also, in that book room, we have some short reads that are similar to what you would see possibly on the STAR. The length of those passages are about the same thing. And they have the critical thinking components built into those, though. And then there's also some benchmark assessment books, and the teachers use those to make sure that they're hitting that instructional level for those students. So the leveled book rooms, the teachers have access to those through online. They can go in, they can see who has checked out what books already so that they know what is available to them. They can look and find their learning focus. And every campus I've gone to, the teachers over and over have said, this is the best thing ever. They're so excited to have this resource. Another big hit with the kids has been our comp clubs, our comprehension clubs. The comprehension clubs are sets of books that are high interest level. And what really gets the kids excited in this is that they're teacher facilitated, but they allow the kids to really interact with each other and have discussions about the books. And we also have been able to push in our other district initiative, our writing. And so the kids have discussions, and then they write about the text that they're reading. And the kids really love these comp clubs. We've had lots of training. One of the trainings that we had actually last year with Scholastic was a leadership training where the instructional coaches were all pulled together and they developed a self-assessment for the teachers to use. And our teachers are really self-reflective now, even more so now than before. But they take this self-assessment, They kind of score themselves, and then this information is shared with our scholastic coaches so that the scholastic coaches know which direction to go in or to move towards on each campus. This yellow book has been the meat of our work, really. It's what all of our trainings pretty much have been based around. Scholastic has provided us with training on the ABCs of guided reading using this book. We've had guided reading lesson planning and trainings. We have had the word study and the guided writing next step. We've had data planning, data trainings, helping us to know how to look at the data and move forward with it. And then our biggest and most successful are the on-site coaching and the virtual coaching. And this is one example of how the coaching is set up. And that white piece of paper, for each level in guided reading, you have behaviors to notice and to support. And that's what drives the meat of what we're doing. And our coaches, our scholastic coaches, have come in. They have looked at those behaviors to notice. They've met with teachers. They plan lessons with the teachers. And then the scholastic coaches have gone in and they've modeled with a group of students that the teachers have chosen to show our teachers how the lesson should look. And so those two pictures, that's one of a planning session with a scholastic coach, and then that coach is then doing the lesson. And this is another scholastic coach that we had on a campus, and you can see in the slide, she is working with a group of students, and the teachers are watching her, so they've already planned it. And we do have a short little video to show you.
Horseshoe. A horseshoe, exactly. Yeah, exactly. So that makes sense. Good job. So what is your new fact that you learned about bats?
The They can go inside flowers and drink all the honey.
The nectar, that's right. And that's what we were just talking about a few minutes ago, because when we looked on this page right here, if you would turn to page 13, we just discussed this, because when I first saw this picture, just like he did, I thought that was a mouse or a rat. I thought, but this book's about bats. And why does he...
So
I had to go up here, and it says, can you read that sentence to us?
However, some bats catch fish and some bats eat nectar from flowers.
Very good. Good job.
And that's just a little snippet.
Exactly.
A little snippet of some of the things that are happening, but it does give you the process of how the coaches then come in and have conversations with the students.
So that's a lot of information in a short time about all of the work we've done with reading. But one thing, if you noticed in the video there, she was really listening to individual students read, which is much like a lot of us do at home with our kids. You pull your kid up in your lap, you read a book with them, and it's very similar in the classroom, only instead of kids crawling up in their teacher's lap, they're sitting around a horseshoe table, and the teacher is listening in to each individual student and then giving them guidance and immediate feedback about the reading that they're doing. So now we're going to tell you a little bit about the math training and resources that we've been doing. Lorraine Campos.
Hi, this is the first year that we have had math solutions come in, and they've started training our grades 3 through 5 math teachers. Math solution moves away from a procedural understanding of math to a deeper conceptual understanding of math. We have one of our trainers who has come in from Math Solutions and a few words that she has to say about our district.
Well, hello, I'm Dr. Monica Kendall. I am a consultant with Math Solutions. And let me just say, I have been so thrilled to be here in San Angelo coaching your elementary and middle school teachers. One reason why I'm so thrilled is because they are so eager to not only experience new things, but to share their own experiences with others. And the second thing that gets me so thrilled is that when I go into their classrooms, they have real learning communities going on so that the kids will talk, and, you know, it's like they're developing little mathematicians that are going to grow up to be big mathematicians, and we're all mathematicians, and that's something that we really want kids to get across. You know, we have a lot of work to do, but just believing in yourself and knowing that you can and wanting to work and try new things is such a huge hurdle to overcome. And I just want to say how proud I am of your teachers for taking the risk and being willing to do just that.
This slide shows a book that was provided for all of the principals. In this book, one of the methods that they talk about is using upside-down teaching, where in the regular normal instruction, you do the gradual release, which is an I do, we do, you do model. And in this book, it talks about how in math, the kids need to have that time to experiment and experience the math. So it's an upside down model where it's a you do, we do, I do. So the teacher is more of a facilitator in that classroom instead of leading the instruction step by step. This is a copy of the Instructional Practices Inventory. This is a form that Math Solution uses when they trained our principals and our teachers and our instructional coaches on this form. This is kind of a look for of things that you look for in a math classroom. They were trained on it at their campuses. We did district walkthroughs with the Math Solutions team, and we used this form when we walked through the classrooms and just kind of looked for all of these practices. And the teachers actually, Math Solutions came in and did some model lessons for our teachers as well in the classrooms. They modeled an entire lesson for the classroom. Teachers, after that, they set goals using this instructional practices inventory form. This book, Give Me Five, this is a book that all of the instructional coaches were given. This is a book that talks about five collaborations, the collaboration between the coach, the teacher, the principal, and it's basically talking about building that understanding, having designing lessons that are critical lessons with high rich tasks involved in them. This book, the Good Questions book, was given to all of our teachers at the very first training that they attended before school started in August. This book is a really important book. It talks about how we have an open question versus a closed question. A closed question in math is a question that has one right answer, and using the open questions, you meet kids at their level, wherever they may be. So here's an example of a closed versus open question, where it's talking about an area of a garden, and it tells you the length is 5 and the width is 6. What is the area? There's only one answer to that. But if you present it a different way, you're going to get multiple answers. If they said, I want to make a garden in the shape of a rectangle, I have 30 yards of fence, what can be the area of my garden? At one of the trainings that they did for our teachers, they also talked about talk moves and the importance of having discourse in the math classroom. We have provided the math talk move poster for all of our math classrooms in grades 3 through 5. We have also made this book available to the teachers. This book has embedded videos of teachers who are actually using talk moves in the classroom. And it's been said that the person doing the most talking in the classroom is the person doing the most learning. So we want our students using the vocabulary, having those conversations, justifying their answers, and having the opportunity to do that. We have a video now from a couple of our teachers in the district who have attended several of the trainings. We're going to go ahead and show you this and let you kind of see what they are getting out of all the Math Solutions trainings they have been attending.
As a first-year teacher, Math Solutions has really helped me with building productive lessons in my classroom. It's taught me ways to use math talk and build constructive conversations with my kids to where they can participate in the learning, so it's more of like a mutual learning environment where they're teaching me and I'm teaching them at the same time. As well as using open-ended questions, which is kind of what we talked about today, where the kids can just kind of create onto the question that I give them. And so that way they're able to just, I guess, expand on it in their own unique way.
I think something that's helped me, this is my fourth year teaching math, and one thing that's helped me is the math talks, because a student will answer something and I'll ask another student to repeat what they said and then expand on it. Like, why do you think they answered it, right or wrong? I want to know if another student is thinking the same way somebody else is, because they learn better from each other than mm-hmm. from me. So I think that's been helping building the connection, because somebody will connect with something and then another kid will be like, oh, I didn't think about it like that. That is, you know, that's a good point. And I think it helps build the connections. Whereas if it was just me just talking, I don't think they would get all the connections with the math talk. I also like breaking up the question, because I think sometimes, especially my kids, will look at something and they'll be like, oh, this is so long, and they're just done. Mm-hmm. So I think taking it sentence by sentence helps them understand, oh, I can do this because I understand this sentence. And if I get the first one, I get the second one, and then it all kind of starts coming together.
For sure.
So I hope this hasn't been so long that you're just done. But we're seeing some really great results with the trainings and the resources that we have provided across the district. The main thing is that teachers are more confident in their practice. We're seeing more engaging lessons, so students are eager to learn because the lessons are more engaging for them. We're also seeing growth with our students. We are tracking student growth with our the NSGRA assessment kits, and we're seeing huge gains with kids in reading, which is one of the main goals that we have. We want every kid reading and reading well. And consistency across the district has been fantastic. Kids that are mobile, if a new student comes into a classroom, we can look at data and immediately know exactly where we need to start with the learning in the classroom, because everyone's being assessed in the same way. So it's been wonderful.
I wanted to really commend this team. You can see they have worked very, very hard and diligently, and this is our first year to have our content facilitators, and it has been a phenomenal addition to our team. I think our principals and our campuses, teachers and ICs, we all just really appreciate the support and appreciate your support. We've been able to be in classrooms and seeing this moving forward. The learning is unbelievable. So I know we're just really looking forward to seeing results from this with our MAP data. You know, at the beginning of the year, it showed us where our students were in their skills in math and reading all the way through eighth grade. So we're really looking forward to that middle of year data that we're going to be getting. We get that in February to see the growth that our students will be making as a result of all of this work. So thank you so much. Do you have any questions?
Thank you, ladies. We appreciate that very much. Do we have any questions?
No, I just had a comment.
Go ahead, Gerard.
I just wanted to say thank y'all for the work y'all been doing. I watching those videos, I really enjoyed watching, you know, just talking, like with the reading comprehension, you know, it doesn't matter how fast you read, you know, it's if you understand what you're reading and comprehending what you're reading. I love that they were having that discussion with the teachers, and then they're doing the same thing with math.
Yes.
Because there's a lot of things you miss in math, and then someone just happens to say it over here during the discussion, and then it all clicks. Mm-hmm. So that is that's a big jump, and I'm really happy seeing that going on.
Thank you. We're hearing, I think, for the first time from students as well. I know our principals can attest to that as well. They're eager to talk about it, talk about their learning. We hear parents say that they're hearing their students talk about it. So it's encouraging and exciting that it really fits our learner profile. We feel that this is moving the work forward and that our students are really benefiting from it. So thank you.
Go ahead. Dr. Ritter, I just want to thank you and your staff. I'm extremely proud of our curriculum and instruction staff. I'm also proud of our teachers that were mentioned on the video, because they are modeling learning. And it's the same thing that is happening in our classrooms. I think when we enhance our craft as professionals and teachers, then our kids will benefit. So I'm extremely honored to participate on the side of this process, and just so glad we have a wonderful curriculum instruction staff. I do want to highlight that Stacy and Lorraine were not only classroom teachers and extremely successful, they were district teachers of the year. Cherie Braden and her principalship was one of the top, her school was one of the top seven elementary schools in the state of Texas, and that's all based on data and performance. So we're excited about what the curriculum instruction staff is doing. I can't tell you enough about the implementation of guided and shared reading. And really the difference between guided and shared reading is really the level of support by the staff and the teacher. And that also applies to the area of mathematics. When you talk about the IU, I do, we do, you do, in my days it was a two with and by. To the kid, with the kid, and by the kid. And so those practices are the same. I think when you look at our math solutions in Scholastic, these are really support that comes from a nationwide perspective. So the data that Math Solutions utilizes and the data that Scholastic utilizes are from going in classrooms across the nation and to see what provides the most academic gains. So these are research-based and vetted practices based on the quality instruction, and I'm so glad that we're implementing them and that we are seeing these gains in our classroom. As you can see also the formative assessments, there are many multiple assessments that are being utilized throughout the year. It's not just autopsy data, but it's continuous data, midpoint data, beginning of the year data, and endpoint data to assess where our kids are. And in, you know, the dreaded acronym in education, the ZPD, the Zone of Proximal Development, basically means we are taking each kid at their instructional step. So at their own individual instructional step, and we're basing our instruction where they need to go as a learner. So I'm so pleased that the learner profile is seamlessly integrated with this. So you heard much about critical thinking and in the collaboration with all students in groups. So these days you can ask Siri on a closed-ended question. And Siri will provide you the answer. But that's why it's so critical for us to focus also on the open-ended question and really talk about problem-solving and critical thinking. So I'm excited about the work our curriculum instruction staff is doing. Many of our principals and department staff are out in the audience this evening, so I just thank them and commend them on the excellent work they're doing. Things are going well, and our kids are moving forward academically. And so I want to thank the school board for setting the conditions for success as well and reallocating the funds needed to improve performance in the classroom. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr.
Thanks, Dr. Detloff. Mr. Parker?
I just wanted to also express my appreciation to Ms. Dr. Ritter and Cherie and her group, and also wanted to just point out, is there any surprise that Dr. Detloff's daughter was just voted best communicator on the volleyball team.
That's awesome. Yes. That's great.
Any other questions? Yeah, go ahead.
First of all, I'd also like to thank you guys so much for all the work that you've done. And it's been so great watching this kind of from the beginning and now seeing it actually materialize. It's been really fun to watch. But I was wondering, as a parent of kids in the district, and I'm assuming that other parents will be watching this, what can we as parents do to support our kids and the schools with these programs? I mean, obviously reading with the kids, but in the math part, or are there other things that we can do specifically to help?
I know that... and I can speak, but sure you can say more about this too, and they may have more ideas. You know, what our students are seeing in the classrooms, what's being modeled for them and for their teachers in the classrooms, they're eager to come home and share that with their parents. You know, gone are the days that we just sit down and work through or memorize words, or it's about interaction and collaboration, and the more that parents can sit down and work with their children through a word problem and talk about the questioning, ask them questions about how they collaborated in their classroom through problem solving, critical thinking, and allow those conversations with reading and allowing the child to read to them. Those are strong. That is how we're going to build literacy and the numerical concept, the conceptual knowledge that they need to be successful, and build that critical thinking through conversation and collaboration at home and helping them with that thinking. Want to add to any of that?
only thing I would add is if you do have a child who's struggling in school, communication with the teacher, with the principal. I know teachers will give you very specific things to do at home with a child. Behaviors to notice and support. If you had a child that you wanted to work with at home, you could get a copy of specific behaviors to notice and support for your child's individual reading level. So even more specific for a parent, you know, if they talk to the teacher.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Other questions or comments? Thank you all very much. We appreciate it. I'm anxious to see what next steps are as we move forward.
And, yes, it's exciting.
So I'm looking forward to, you know, us not only improving performance, but having a track record that indicates that we're, you know, going to continue to improve. So thank you all.
We have some excited teachers out there. They're loving teaching.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, we'll move to item 8 on our agenda, which is consent items. Do we have a motion to approve our consent items this evening?
Move to approve the consent items.
Second. We have a motion from Mr. Parker and a second from Dr. Kingman. Do we have any? Item A is consider donations. We just received one donation this past month, but we appreciate Walmart and the good people there and for their contribution. Item B is consider approval of our quarterly investment report ending November 30th, 2018. Item C is consider our cooperative purchasing agreement organizations. Item D is to consider bid number 18-030 for dual purpose paper. And item E, which I think Mr. Kimball added to our list that was in our board book, another recommendations for another person to work in the district. So we've got item E would be consider superintendent's recommendations for personnel for the school year. And I would remind, remind those that are left in the room, remind those that might be watching on our public access channel that we have reviewed all of these items in a earlier pre-agenda board workshop. So do we have any other comments about items A through E? Do we have any public comment? If not, all in favor of our motion, please indicate by saying aye. Aye. Any opposed, indicate by saying no. Excuse me, our motion passes. Our next item is to consider bills, accounts, and financial statements for the month of November of 2018.
Move for approval.
We have a motion from Mr. Dendel and a second from Mr. Hernandez to approve our bills, accounts, and financial statements for November of 2018. Do we have any board comment or questions concerning our financial statements?
Mr. Lehman, just a note to those watching on our public access channel that we've reviewed all these reports in a previous pre-agenda board meeting. Also, all of these reports can be found online or on our website, saisd.org. Under a tab marked Financial Transparency.
Thanks, Mr. Dendel. Do we have any other comments or questions from our board team? Any public comment? If not, all in favor of our motion, please indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed, indicate by saying no. Our motion passes. Our next item is to consider the proposed amendment to the district's official budget in our general fund.
Move for approval.
We've got a slow seconding bunch this evening. We have a motion from Mr. Dendel and a second from Mr. Hernandez to approve our amendment. Let me get to that. To the general fund, and this is an amendment that makes it's a change in function codes, but does not result in any monetary differences. Do we have any further comments from our board team?
That's correct, Mr. Lane. We're just moving an amount from one category to another to more closely classified as an expense.
Okay. Thanks, Mr. Nindo. Any other comments or questions concerning our motion? Any public comment? If not, all in favor, please indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed, indicate by saying no. Our motion passes. Our next item is item 11 to consider our proposed amendment to the district's official budget, and this is in the food service fund.
Move for approval.
We have a motion from Mr. Dendel and a second from Dr. Kingman. to approve the food service budget amendment for December 17th of 2018. This does increase our expenditures in the amount of $137,000. Do we have any further comment or questions from our board team?
Mr. Lehman, just again, another added comment on that. We are buying a refrigerated truck, which increased our expenses for the food service fund budget for this period.
Thanks, Mr. Dendel. Yeah, we're purchasing a refrigerated delivery truck for that amount, and that will come straight, when you make purchases of that nature, they come straight from that particular fund. So there's been a number of years when we had too much money in that fund and our auditor didn't like it, so it sounds like Dr. Bright's spending that. So do we have any other further comments or questions from our board team? Any public comment? If not, all in favor of our motion, please indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed, indicate by saying no. Our motion passes. Our next item, one of our favorite items as a board, is the district's calendar for 2019-2020. And Ms. Hullahan's going to help us with that. Shelley, I'll turn it over to you.
Thank you so much. Board members, informal input was gathered through conversations with teachers, administrators, as well as surveys from the past. And last year, you'll remember that we did a very large survey on a couple different options. And so we used that to really help with the developing of the calendar this year. When we look at the calendar, there's a lot of we must do. And one of those is that we must have 75,600 minutes for student instruction. Minutes are determined by the first bell ringing to the last bell ringing. That's how we calculate minutes. Also, as we look at the calendar, because in the past we always had designated bad weather days. We no longer have designated bad weather days, but we have to include those minutes. So now the 75,600 minutes has now increased to 76,440 minutes. With all that said, we're going to be great. Okay. Teachers must have 187 teacher contract days. As a district, we believe that the first day of school should start with a 2, and it does on this calendar. It is August 21st, 2019. Due to a number of reasons, attendance and aligning with districts across Texas, the Monday and Tuesday of Thanksgiving will now be a student holiday. Spring break is aligned with Angelo State University and Howard College, which is March 9th through the 13th, 2020. I can't even believe I'm saying that date. And the last day of instruction is May 29th, 2020, with graduation being held on May 30th. 2020. There will be minor changes in the assessment dates. You'll notice that on the second and third week in May, there's these little dotted lines, and that usually is when we do the EOC, the state assessment. We got a calendar late Friday that they're moving that window to include 3 weeks, so that's not on this calendar, but we'll adjust that before it goes online. I am asking the board to approve the calendar recommendation as presented for the 2019-2020 school year. And is there any questions?
Thanks, Shelley. Questions from our board team? Good job. Do we have a motion to approve?
I'll make a motion to approve the recommended. Let me start over. I'll make a motion to approve the recommended 2019-20 SAISD district calendar.
Thanks, Gerard. Do we have a second? We have a second from Mr. Hernandez. So we have a motion from Mr. Gallegos and a second from Mr. Hernandez. And I think Shelley did a great job of outlining that. Much of our calendar is very similar to what we've done historically. We're starting a little bit later. As Shelley said, we are starting with a 2, but an early 2. But we are starting with on the 21st, and then there's been a number of, I certainly receive comments every year about why other districts take off the week of Thanksgiving and we don't, so I won't have to answer those questions anymore. And then historically our districts and really any calendars or any opinions that we've solicited from the public have always insisted that we get out of school prior to the first part of June. So we're accomplishing all of that and still going the required minutes. In fact, I think Shelley filled us in the other day that in every case we're extended, we're going beyond the minimum number of minutes required by the state for instruction. So that's kind of a capsule summary of the calendar. Do we have any other board comments? Go ahead, Dr. Detloff.
Thank you, Mr. Lehman. I just want to thank Ms. Holohan. I believe this is 12 years of really facilitating the leadership role in the calendar. So working alongside the board, Shelley has had 12 years of developing the calendar with input from our constituents, community, and staff. And I will say, if there's ever a topic with opinions, perhaps strong opinions, it would be the school calendar. So thank you, Shelley, for the work you do in developing that alongside our board.
Yeah, what we found out through the years is not only do parents have strong opinions about it, but our staff members do as well. You know, so it's, but I think we've struck a good compromise. And again, with 12 years of experience, I think we're getting less and less controversial every year when we develop our calendar. Any other comments? Is there public comment concerning our calendar? If not, all in favor, please indicate by saying, oh, no, we don't have a motion. Do we have a motion?
Yeah, I made a motion.
Okay, thanks. Oh, you made that. Recommended. Okay. So all in favor of our motion, please indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed, indicate by saying no. Our motion passes. Our next item is item 13, and Dr. Bright's going to walk us through this.
Thank you, Mr. Lehman. Tonight, the school district administration would like for you to consider some minor changes to single-member District 6 and single-member District 3 voting districts. Mr. Gallegos was first elected by the voters of single-member District 6 in 2005 and has served really as a champion of children for over 13 years now. And during his tenure on the board, my recollection is that Mr. Gallegos has primarily resided in rented or leased properties along the way. And recently, he has made the great leap and has become a full-fledged homeowner in San Angelo ISD, moving just a few blocks away from his previous address. Now, the reason we're here tonight is that the house he has permanently purchased is actually a couple blocks outside of single member District 6. It actually sits in Dr. Keeman's single member District 3 boundary. And we know the next census will be conducted in 2020, and that will likely have major adjustments to every single member district boundary that we have. And according to our attorney, it's really customary to consider incumbents as voting districts are redrawn after each census. Now, due to this recent permanent move of Mr. Gallegos, we did contact our attorney to seek some legal advice on what we needed to do, and we asked Templeton Demographics out of South Lake, Texas, to consider minimal changes to single-member District 6 and single-member District 3 in order to allow Mr. Gallegos the opportunity to continue representing his current constituents in single-member District 6. Should they wish to allow, you know, to keep him in there when the next election comes up on May the 4th. So what I'd like for you to do is take a look at the maps that are provided in the packet. We have a current map and we have a proposed change. You'll notice that there is a net change of 237 voters added to the roll of single member District 6. And there will be a net decrease of 237 voters in Dr. Kingman's single member District 3, should you choose to accept those maps. So really, should you choose to accept the changes as presented, you know that we will take all the necessary steps with the County Elections Office to make sure these changes happen as smoothly as possible. So that's really my spill at this point. You've got a lot of information in your packet to look at, and you've had it for a while. So, Dr. Detloff, if you have anything you want to add to that, please step in.
Thank you, Dr. Bright. I just want to thank you for working with our, I believe it's Templeton Demographics out of the Metroplex, as well as with our school district attorneys on this. And again, I want to thank Mr. Gallegos for his service to our district for 13 years. I had the privilege to complete the years of experience on a recent nomination. Our school board was nominated for the HEB Excellence in Education Award, and so I had the privilege and the pleasure to fill out our school board experience, and I believe we are pushing up to the double digit mark in school board experience. About 10 years experience is the average on our school board, so it's a privilege to serve with these men and women, and I think that certainly helps our school district as a whole. So thank you, Mr. Gallegos, for your service, and thank you, Dr. Bright, for making sure this is you followed procedures and protocols in doing this.
Thanks, Dr. Detloff. Any other comments or questions from our board team? We have a motion to approve, Mr.
Yes, Parker. I just wanted to say that we've always been trained that if we have an opportunity to, as board members, that if we have an opportunity to better our families or better our situations, that and we have to move, that if there's any way that we move outside our districts, that our boundaries are readjusted so that that board member or trustee can continue serving on the on our school board. Sometimes that can't happen. Sometimes you're miles away from your district. Here, it's just two blocks. We're only going to have to tweak. That's what I think the words should be. Just tweak our boundary lines to go ahead and include Mr. Gallegos, who's, as you've said, has been on our board 13 years. He's very well liked. He's very well respected, and he does an excellent job representing his district, and he does an excellent job representing our whole district as a whole. He attends community and school events all over the city, not just in his district, and he has children that are still in our school district. And he does a good job staying trained and attending all the seminars and conferences that we have. And I just think for the betterment of our district, this is a win-win for us to try to keep him on the board. So I would, with that said, I would move that we approve the proposed change to the boundaries of single member districts 3 and 6 that's been presented by Dr. Bright. And I further move to authorize the administration to take all steps necessary to effectuate this change.
Okay, real
Mr.
quick.
Mr. Lehman, I think we're going to
Recuse ourselves from the vote. Yeah. So, go ahead. Thank you.
So we're asking both of them to step out since it involves their districts. But I'll be glad to second Mr. Parker's motion. And since Gerard's not here, I'll say good things about him. I'm glad Max mentioned how diligent Gerard is in training, and what a great job he does in representing our district. He goes far above and beyond, you know, what's expected of a normal board member, and always represents us in a really outstanding manner. He attends outside training. He comes to all of our meetings. He's very active, and he's been elected numerous times by the public. So I think it's only makes sense for us to make this small change. And then, as was mentioned earlier, in 2020 we'll have a new census, and then many of the districts will change, potentially change at that particular time. But until then, Dr. Bright's been it's been good for him to make sure that we're doing everything that we need to do now to continue working as an effective board team. So do we have any comments from the public? If not, I'll call our motion. All in favor, please indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed, indicate by saying no. Our motion passes.
Amy,
you can. Yeah. Thanks, Mr. Gill. Dr. Kingman really didn't want to give up those 237 voters, but
darn.
But, again, we've been working on this, and we appreciate the hard work that our administrative team has done. Moving forward, our announcements. Our Page graduation is this week, December 19th, at High School Sarah Bernhardt Theater. We normally have two, or we do have two graduations a year for Page, but this is the first one in a program that I know our board is very proud of. So we have a number of folks that I think have already reached out to Becky about helping us with accepting graduates. So we won't worry about that this evening. Put on your calendars, please. We get recognized on an annual basis by City Council. We have a City Council meeting that recognizes our board on January 8th at 8:30 a.m. They usually do a good job of making the recognitions early. So if you need to attend as a board member, please, again, let Becky know. And then our January meeting schedule is our workshop and pre-agenda workshop meeting is scheduled for January 14th, and our regular board meeting is scheduled for January the 21st. Now, we are going to go into closed session this evening, and we're going to do so in accordance with the Texas Open Meetings Act, Texas Government Code 551, subchapters D and E, and we're going to do so to discuss personnel matters, which is 551074. Okay, we are back in regular session. We appreciate patience from everyone. We made no decisions in closed session, nor did we take any votes, of course. And hearing no objection, we'll stand adjourned.